Jack, we are ready for Jack doing his tunes about his urns.
I'll give you a little bit about my background. I grew up in my father's woodworking shop and did very little turning in the early years. And then I always wanted to get into art, and then I was working on a clay sculpture of a nude about this tall, and my wife asked me to make some candle holders for Thanksgiving. I haven't finished that sculpture, and I haven't stopped turning wood, and that's been about 16 years now. And the reason I got into doing urns is a friend of mine from church asked me to make an urn for her husband who was deceased, who I knew. And that one was a square box. And so then I started making more urns, and everyone's different. And what I do is I rough out a lot of blanks out of wet wood and get them hollowed out. This one's still a little wet. And then I put them on shelf to dry, and then I have an assortment of them, so when I got an order for one, I can finish one up in 2 or 3 days, or at least till the ashes get back from a crematory. So I've just been having a ball turning, and the nice thing about turning is you can spend 5 minutes or 5 hours, and it's like taking a vacation without going anyplace, because when you're there turning on the lathe, you're not paying attention to anything else. You're just zoned in on that. And there's so many different woods and so many different shapes and so many different things you can do to decorate them. There's always something new to explore, so you really never lose interest in it. What I have here is a piece of sycamore. And if you look at these rays in here, there's some distinct rays in this wood here that's kind of unique to a sycamore. And once you see it, recognize sycamore, you can almost always pick it out. And this piece is a little bit wet. And I've got a moisture tester here that I got at my candy store, Harbor Freight, and it does a pretty good job. And this says it's about 20-22% moisture, 28% there. This is sweet gum that I turned January 1, and I put it in a Home Depot yard and leaf bag, double wall bag in my shop, and close it up and set it aside, and it's reading about 10% right now. So it's ready to do a final turning, and these are hollowed out. So one of the requirements for an urn is it needs to hold 200 cubic inches. And usually from a crematory, you get a box of 6 by 6 by 6, and that's 216 cubic inches. And because there is some shrinkage, I tried to turn them so there's 110, 120 cubic inches in it. And so I hollow them out. I kind of get a rough shape on the outside, and then I hollow them out and make sure it's big enough on the inside, and then I know how much more I can take off on the outside. What I'm going to do first is do some hollowing on the inside of this. It needs quite a bit out of it, and I'm not going to spend all night turning on it. But this is spindle turning. The grain is going with the lathe. And this is a hook tool that I got a number of years ago, and it's really the fastest thing for getting this hollowed out. And it doesn't clog up and jam up like a ring tool. But you cannot use it on bowl turning when the grain is at right angle to the lathe. Everybody got that? So I'm going to be cutting on the inside, and I want the maximum RPM I can without vibrating. Well, let me point out something. There's a soft side here and a hard side. This is came out of a 36-inch diameter piece of log, and so this side's heavier here towards the heartwood, and this is kind of spalted here on the towards the bark. So as I get more and more out of the inside, there'll be vibration be less pronounced. Usually I'm on the other side of the lathe, so I can really push into this. You can see by the chips that's coming out, it's cutting it pretty fast. And I've got all the tools that you can go in there with just a point, like a quarter inch bit for a metal lathe, but it turns it into powder, and this is easier to clean out. And I got my little rake, garden rake here. And yeah, that just brings it out real easy. But normally at the shop, is what I do is I hold my hand like this and I stick the air hose right there and blow it out, and my hand deflects the.
Jack, would you show the cutting edge to the camera on the tool rest there?
I sharpen this on the inside. And you want it nice and smooth on the outside, sharpener on the inside. I got this from Michael Holsnick from Canada. It really works good. So anyhow, then after I get it all hollowed out to what I think is correct, I leave it in the chuck and I take it out and fill it full of sand. So I'm nowhere close now, but let me show you how I do that. And I know I'm not going to use all this, so I'm going to dump out some of this sand, which I keep in here, and it's nice and dry. And this container is 5 inches square on the inside. So for every inch of depth, I've then got 25 cubic inches. So now we dump this back in there.
Good?
Yeah. Set it up. So I've got roughly 100 cubic inches, so I've got half what I need. And that's just easily made out of plexiglass, or you can use other means, but that's the easiest way to get cubic inches instead of ounces. Or drilled it out down to the depth, and I've got a little tool I made here for measuring the depth. It's just a C cut out of Baltic birch plywood and a dowel, and right here at the top I've got a scribe mark. So that's zero, I've got zero to go. So I can put this in here. Now I got it where the bottom is, and you can see I've got about 5/8 of an inch there in the bottom. And it's real easy to make this, and you can make it a small one, a large one, even larger. You can put a deeper throat on it, and cost virtually nothing to make. Because I don't know of any other calipers, whatever you can buy, that will measure depth like that. I get this where it's just about a 32nd of an inch, and then I twist it on there, and it holds it just enough where I can't unturn it. When I shut the lathe off, it won't unscrew. I don't use those fancy washers in there or set screw or anything. I found that, and just a sharp rap when I took it off will bring it off. Let's do a little turning on the outside. And if you use it like this, you can take some wood off of there. But if you then turn it on the side like this, so the wood is sliding across the sharp, you're using the exact same way you'd be using a skew. You got the sharp at a 45 degree angle where it's cutting. And you can see and feel the difference in the cut. Got that? Yeah, this is a regular skew. There's a real good video on the skew. Alan Lacer's The Sweet and Dark Side of the Skew. And I highly recommend it. That's how I learned to just be my friend. But there's so many things that you can do with this at the skew that you really can't do with other tools. And one of them is cutting a little bead in here. Learn to use the point and protect the point, and don't let it so I can cut a nice little groove in there with that. I only sharpen this with a hone, and when all that hollow grind is gone, that's when I'll go to the grinder with it. And you can use it as a negative rake scraper like this, and now I got a line in there. I got a piece of masonite right here, a formica rather, and I can put that in that groove right there, and just like that, burn me a really nice line in there. It's a lot easier to use than a wire, which you can also use. So I have plenty of scrap of that laying around. If you want a really fine edge, you break it, and then you get a really sharp edge that you can put a really fine line on there. Another thing that you can do is burn a line on here, or if you notice that band on that one over there, what I'm doing is transferring the resin from the wood onto the wood here, and it kind of makes it look like leather, and you get a really nice effect there.
What is that, Jack?
This is ebony, but I like using Padauk. Now let me get another smooth area on there. So then I got a piece of Paduke here. And that puts the same thing, only a little different color to it. Any wood with coca bola work, any wood with a lot of resin on it. And then I got this little texture tool. It's a ball bearing in there and a rare earth magnet to hold the tip in there. And this is just a little burr for the Dremel. And then you can do some texturing in there. Let me see if I can get that to show up better now. Yeah. I hollowed this one out January 1 this year. It was wet wood. This is sycamore. I like sycamore when it's wet. It turns just like Bradford pear, really nice, but it's got a lot more grain character to it than Bradford pear. And I got hollowed out to 275 cubic inches when it was wet. So we're good there. And it was too long, so I cut this piece off. So now I can face this off for my threads and then make a topper out of this to go on the top of it and hopefully match up some grain. So the first thing we're going to do is get this off here. And we're going to take the chuck off. We're going to start by turning this between centers. I've got a one-way live center, which is the one I highly recommend because there's how you normally use it, but you've got this cone end that you can put on, and you can put this on this way or this way. Now, this is a 16-penny nail cut off. I got a magnet there to hold on to it. But I can put this 16-penny nail in here and wrap some tape around here. And then I can put this in the headstock, and I can custom make pieces any shape I want. I just drill them and tap them for a 3/4 thread. And I can screw it on there, put it in the headstock, turn any shape I want, and then I can just keep reusing them. And I've got a big cone this big that I made out of Baltic burst plywood with several layers on it. All right. Since it's dried, this has gone oval. So the last thing I do is remove the original center. So I can put it back on center, and I can put this center in there, and now I can turn it between centers, and you can see that wobble, and you see how far out of true that is. And so I'm going to attempt to true that up. You can see how much over we've got there. I've got a 1/4-inch bowl gouge, and I'm going to go back in there and clean up the inside of it with a skew. I'm getting a little bit too far off the tool rest there, but now I'm going to use the skew and clean up that I don't want to get too much of, on that dovetail. And now I've got a little bit big there. I'm going to take a little bit off so it's not quite so deep. Thank you. It's not going to work that way. All right, now I got a nice clean corner in there. Yeah. It's very important that the wood is sitting on this top edge, not the bottom edge. If it's sitting on the bottom, you get a catch or get too much of a torque on it, it will come out. Thank you. All right, now I'm going to bring the tailstock in and all right, so I'm going to true up the outside first. I'm going to turn it by hand all the way around before I turn the power on, because that obviously would have been a problem had I turned the power on, turned the speed all the way down, then bring it up and make sure everything's tight. And I'm going to go back with my roughing gouge. Quite have it close enough yet to use this like a skew. I can look up here and down here and I can see where I still got a shadow left, and I got to turn until I have no shadow. And I can tell by the color of the wood with a fresh cut, and that's running pretty smooth there now. But there's still an area that I haven't got into. There's nice shavings coming off there as I'm using it like a skew. I'm getting nice long continuous ribbon. Now I'm going to use my bowl gouge to go down around the sides here. This has not got a fingernail grind on it. This is more conventional grind. There you go. you use a fingernail grind or Ellsworth grind or what else they call Irish grind. And both of them have their advantages, and the angle of your grind on the back also determines where your handle's going to be. So I have more bowl gouges than any other tool. And I use the bowl gouge more than I use any other tool. Well, watch out that I don't run into my metal there. If you want a clean cut, you've got to be rubbing the bevel. If you're just putting the sharp in there, or if you feed this way, pushing the tool, you're going to get all those little ripples in there. You feed the tool from back here. You do everything from back here. You steer it and you feed it from here. And what you're doing is letting it slide down that bevel. So this hand's just holding it onto the tool rest. And everything else is being done with my left hand right now. And that cut is silky smooth right there now. And the way you're working with the bowl gouge, the flute goes in the direction that you're cutting. And normally you want it at 10 or 11 o'clock. That would be 12 o'clock or 1 or 2 o'clock. And you're actually starting your cut right down here on the bottom. When that sharp is vertical, you're slicing off the fiber, and the rest of it is just pulling your chip out. And all of you have cut yourself with paper at one time or another. How do you cut yourself with paper? By it sliding across your skin. And if you look at that piece of paper or this edge here under a microscope, is going to look like a serrated knife. And so it's cutting that fiber, and the rest is just pulling it out. But you got to rub the bevel to get that smooth cut. Right here you can see some ripples right there where I wasn't rubbing the bevel real hard. Can you see them? And you see there's one area right here I still haven't gotten down there.
Where's the bottom of the inside?
No, it's about there.
Is where it's touching the jaw is going to be your foot?
Yeah, I'll cut that off the last thing. Last thing I do. Sometimes I even finish it before I cut that off. All right, we pretty much good all the way across there down to this end. And you can't rub the bevel on a bouncy cut and get a clean cut. So if your wood's uneven, the procedure you do is hold it really tight with this hand on the tool rest. What I do is I hold back with this hand and push with this hand, get my arms and the tool and everything under tension, and then I take a lot of the slop out of it. If you just have that on the tool rest like this, there's just no control. It's too sloppy. So I get my hand up against the tool rest, I hold the tool real tight, and I'm just using the sharp. I can't rub the bevel because it's an uneven surface. And so I'll just use that sharp until I find my continuous cut. Once I've got my continuous cut, then I can rub the bevel. And here again, I'm not feeding with this, because if I push this way to feed it, I'm going to push it off the tool, and then I'm going to push it back on, off, and back on. And that's why you're going to get all those ripples. So once you get your bevel run nice and smooth, then you can get a continuous cut. Now, if you start forcing your cut too much, it's going to start bouncing on you. Particularly bowl turning, where you've got end grain and side grain, because that end grain doesn't cut as easy as the side grain. And so when you're putting a lot of pressure on it, you're going to cut faster on the side grain, and it's going to start bumping on you. So what you got to do is stop, come back, find a place that's not bouncing on you, go back, start to cut all over again. And if you're taking too heavy a cut, you can't get a smooth cut there. So I was starting to get too much of a cut, so I stepped up a little bit, took a bunch off, and then I come back for another whack at it. Okay, I've got it pretty reasonable trued up, so I'm going to go back with my skew for large diameter pieces. I've got more of a surface that the wood is sliding across, and I've got a little bit heavier tool, a little bit of weight there that helps me control it, so I don't start getting a bounce in it. And you can see these nice long shavings that are coming off here. So that's nice and smooth there, and now I need to go back this other direction and start right about there and get that cleaned up. And I rotate this tool a little bit to get over to a sharp edge. Put my tool on there and it's bouncing on me, so I gotta come back and find a place where it's not bouncing and start that cut again. And I need to switch hands here. Got a little bit of a hump right there, more than I can sand out, so I want to cut that out. You can tell more of feeling it, you're even closing your eyes, and you get a better feel of what's there and what you need to do. Okay. Next thing I would be doing is sanding this. And we got some dark lines in here where the tool's been rubbing on it and the wood's been compressed a little bit. And you feel it with your hand, oh, I can start with 220. But you'll never cut deep enough to get those compressed wood fibers out of there. So I always start with 80 grit. I do my work with 80 grit, so the wood is all uniform, there's no little lines showing up in it. And then you can go through your rest of your grits really fast, because all they're doing is getting rid of the scratches from the previous sandpaper. You know, in theory you could level the Rocky Mountains with a garden rake, but it ain't never going to happen, right? You start with too fine a sandpaper, you're going to be sanding, 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 and pretty soon you get tired, oh, the finish will cover that up. No, the finish makes it worse. Does anybody know why? You ever had you're sanding, you got these little white lines that you can hardly see, and then you put a finish on it, it's a dark line. How come?
Because
what's happening is that little scratch has all those little fiber ends in it, and they're reflecting the light out. Think of a valley, river valley, full of dogwoods. It's going to reflect all the light out. As soon as you fill that valley full of water, it's going to trap all the light, and it's going to go from light to dark. That's what's happening. That makes sense to you?
Yes.
All right, now I'm going to face off this end here. I'm on. I'm planning on using this for a cover and use a good bit of the diameter. That's the reason I'm not rounding this way off here. All right, let me. Check and make sure my chuck is still tight, because it will loosen up a little bit in turning. And oh, I knew something was wrong. I'm using this small bowl gouge because I'm taking a smaller cut, and that way I've got better control. The heavier cut I've taken here, the more torque I'm going to put on it that's going to want to throw it out of there. Take my time with a nice length cut, eyeballing it so it's flat, and then I can put my tool on there and I got it perfectly flat. Okay, and now the inside's not running true, so I want to chew that up. I try to keep some blanks on hand at all the time, several of them, and then I try to personalize them. There's one up there with for my nephew's wife. So sweet pea was her flower, and so I put a different sweet pea on all four sides of it. And so I, like I said, I always try to do something unique with them. Now I could go in here and take some more out of the inside if I. It's running pretty true. It's not bouncing too much, so it's not too much off center on the inside, but it is some. It will be a little bit oval, so there should be balance out a little bit, but sometimes it'll get way out of whack.
How deep of the base do you need that? You're going to get it thin like you would a regular hollow-form ball, or you're going to thicken down the base to provide stability
over the middle? Well, really all I need to do is make sure I've got 200 cubic inches. The next thing I would do is I'd take one of my rings and glue it on there. All right, so now I've got that ring and I can put some glue on that and put that on there and let it set overnight and glue it. Then I can true this up, turn it. What I use is Type Bond 3. It's got fastest setup. And so anyhow, I can glue this on, then I can turn this off. And this piece is deep enough, I can turn a, well, maybe not quite off. I can cut part of this off after I put it on there. Or I could even, thank you. I could even cut a recess in here, so maybe I'll do that. Let me cut a recess in there.
What do you use to cut the thread?
The Baxter thread cutting jig, and put it on there. All right. Come on. cut a recess in there, and I'm going to start out with the parting tool. Come back with a small spindle gouge and cut a bunch of that out, keeping my tool rest, my tailstock there as long as I can. Notice I'm taking very light cuts. Okay, a little bit sloppy, but it's going to go in there. And I'm going to go ahead and just glue it in there.
A little inlay surrounding
the deck. I guess that'll be all right. Now, if I want, I can put this in there and then use the center hole, but I'm just going to go ahead and use this ring, and I'm going to put some pressure on that and let that start setting up, and we can do some start doing some decoration on this.
Jack?
Yeah?
When you start an urn, what is the basic size dimensions that you start with? Is there some basic...
Good question. Normally I'm about 10 inches tall and 8 inches in diameter. Good starting place. Alright. Like I said, normally I would sand this, but we're just going to go ahead and do some texturing on it. What I'm going to do is I'm going to transfer some resin on there, and I'm going to make a couple bands on there first. And now, because it's not running true, it's not transferring a solid pattern, which I don't want anyhow. Yeah, it looks like this band needs to be a little wider. Okay. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to put a really dark band on each side of that. And so I'm going to start by cutting a little groove in there. I just turned my parting tool sideways. Cut a little groove to start in there. And then put the formica on there. So now that parts it off, makes it a little bit more distinct looking. So I'll do the same down here on the bottom. Okay, so that's how I do that. Another thing I've done is take it and scribe some lines and then burn them in and make it look like a barrel. You can use your tool rest over here and just, it works better if you got a tool rest out, a piece of plywood cut to the curvature that you got, and it's a whole lot easier to keep. But then I can put those lines all the way around if I want and burn those in there and make it look like a barrel. For you new wood turners, if you use wood filler on a void, it's always going to look like wood filler in there. But if you got a little void or something and you take your burning iron and burn it a little bit and make it dark, then it looks like a natural inclusion. So if you got a crack, you highlight the crack, or you do something to make it blend in there. You turn it into art, because you cannot hide it. You absolutely cannot hide it. All right. When it comes to engraving these, like I did one for Gwinnett, I print out what I want on the computer, and then I tape the paper right over here, and then I just burn right through the paper. And then I take the paper off and I go back and touch up a little bit where I need to. And the same thing with putting flowers on there. I'll print out what I want with PowerPoint. I can size it any way I want. I can take one leaf and make 24 different shaped leaves out of that with stretching it and pulling it. And I could just start drawing on here. And then I get over here and oops, I got more space there than I do here. So that's a whoop. So by printing it out on paper and taping it on with some painter's tape, you can keep adjusting it until you're really satisfied with what you want before you start burning it in there. And then I can decorate this with dyes, India ink, watercolor pencils. You can put them on there dry, or you can wet it a little bit and it really get more in there. Also, I use on wet wood, I use watercolor pencil for marking it. A regular pencil won't mark wet wood. Watercolor pencil will mark right in there really, really quick. Nice dark. I've got some purple ones that I use. All right, so after this is set up, I can turn this collar down, make it half of that. I thought about screwing these together and put them in there and cut through both of them, but that's an awful deep cut. And if you try cutting on the bandsaw, it'd be kind of hard to get it straight, and the table saw is going to take out too much wood, so I just deal with the 3/4 inch. Any questions? Yeah?
If you're doing the lettering, is there a particular font that shows up and is more legible?
Well, if you're going to be burning it on there, Times New Roman kind of works best, nice square font to burning it. You can use anything you want, but when you start burning it and you start trying to follow those little tiny lines, you're going to have a problem. I think I used Times New Roman on that urn for. Now, that's not as nice and pretty and uniform as laser or engraving would be, but it's got a personal touch to it. So,
One trick I've done with the laser printer on wood and other stuff we're doing for the theater is if you print it in mirror so that it's backwards when you look at it, you turn the paper over and then you just take an iron to it and it will stick to the wood or stick to the plastic.
With a laser print, yes.
Jack, do the tops of an urn have to be threaded or can you just glue a plug in?
You can just glue a plug in it. This one right here, I had a plug for the bottom and it lost it, but I was just going to glue it in. And if you look at this in the light, you can see this top here is paper thin right here in the top.
How did you finish that orange one there?
This one?
Yeah.
This is ambrosia maple, and I just put some reddish brown dye on it. And then the finish on it is Krylon. And I put that on in the lathe while it's turning as slow as possible in the lathe. And that way I can really lay it on there and I don't get any runs. If you try spraying it like this, you're going to get guaranteed to get runs. But that's why I always leave that button on the bottom and a place on the top so I can put it between centers to sand it, finish it, dye it, everything. And this one right here, this is Coca-Cola on the top. I haven't glued that in yet. I put my label on the bottom there. And this one is 16 threads per inch, which I find is a little fine. So these are 12 threads per inch. Did I pass one of these around?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. And your tolerance isn't quite as, see this one right here, you got a lot of play in with the 12 threads per inch, you got a little bit more tolerance there. And so I leave the bottom so I can put it in the chuck and put the headstock on here. And this one I put blue dye on it, aniline dye, and then I sanded it back and put yellow over top of it. And that's how I get this verde green. Yes, Bob.
Jack, do you inquire as to whether the urn is going into a niche or the ashes are going to be scattered?
Yes, I do.
And is there any standard height for a niche?
12 inches, what I've heard.
Yeah.
I haven't actually, if you're going in a mausoleum. The Catholic faith does not like urns to be scattered. So you can put the urn in several layers of black plastic bag and bury it that way and it will stick around for many, many years if you seal them up good and double or triple bag it. Any other questions? Yes?
Well, I've got a statement about the fonts. Times New Roman is okay, but if you really want a font that's like a headstone, use Trajan Pro. That's more like the font you'll see on headstones in a cemetery.
Okay.
What's it called?
Trajan Pro.
T-R-A-S-I-N?
No, T-R-A-J-A-N.
C-R-A-J-A-N?
T-R-A-J-A-N.
Okay.
And then you can find that in Microsoft Word.
Yeah, okay. I'll have to look for that. But, you know, something with fine squirrely lines and everything on it, you're never going to burn it where it's going to look really good. Okay?
Thank you,
Jeff. You're welcome.